Are you applying for graduate school in chemistry or a related STEM discipline this fall? And if so, are you wondering how to write a good statement of purpose? Then this video is for you. Hi everybody, welcome to Office Hours. My name is Jennifer Lacer. I'm a chemistry professor at the University of Pittsburgh, and today I want to talk a little bit about how to write a good statement of purpose for grad school. I've been spending a bunch of time thinking about this recently, both because I've been helping my undergraduate researchers prepare their application materials, but also because I've seen a lot of both really compelling and not so compelling statements of purpose as a member of my department's admissions committee in the last 3 years. So while there is a lot of good general advice out there on how to write a good statement of purpose for graduate school, not all of it is well targeted to STEM disciplines. So here are some of the things that I wish someone had told me when I was applying and the advice that I pass on to my students. The first important thing to keep in mind is that the entire goal of your statement of purpose, and really your entire application, is to convince the admissions committee that you're going to be a successful and productive graduate student. And so if a sentence or paragraph in your statement of purpose doesn't further that goal, you should consider removing it and replacing it with something that does. I mention this because a lot of students, and I'll be the first to admit that I did this when I applied to graduate school, get really caught up in kind of telling a narrative about their life and how they became a chemist. And so we get a lot of applications that start with things like, when I was growing up, I really enjoyed cooking in the kitchen with my mom, and that love of cooking translated into a love of chemistry. And that's fine, that's great, I'm really glad that you have those positive memories, but it also really doesn't tell me anything about your potential as a graduate student. And so that space would be much better used telling me about your academic interests, your research experience, your career goals, and so on and so forth. That's not to say that some mention of how you became interested in science isn't appropriate. Just try to keep it tied to why you're applying to graduate school. So for example, maybe you entered college as a pre-med, but as you took chemistry classes, you found that you were way more interested in learning how to design and synthesize pharmaceuticals than in prescribing them. That's awesome. Tell me about that. Or maybe you decided to apply to graduate school after a really excellent undergraduate research experience. These things are very relevant to your application, and they help provide me with evidence that you're applying to graduate school because it's really the thing you want to do, not just because it's kind of the next thing. And that brings me to my second point. The second important thing to keep in mind is that the admissions committee in most science departments is actually made up of professors from that department. So your application's not going off and being read in some admissions office way off in the bowels of university administration. It's actually being read by scientists in the discipline that you're applying to study. And what do we do as scientists? We present evidence and we draw conclusions. So if you're at a loss for where to start with your statement of purpose, I encourage you to think about it this way. Present evidence and use that evidence to draw conclusions about why you're going to be an awesome graduate student. So what do I mean when I say present evidence and draw conclusions? Well, let's take describing your undergraduate research as an example. Talking about your undergraduate research experience can be a great way, and it's actually probably the best way to show me that you're ready for graduate school. But the way that you talk about it matters a lot. So for example, here's a description that an undergraduate researcher working in my lab might write about their work. I'm working on synthesizing charged polymers with different charge densities. When oppositely charged polymers mix in solution, they form complexes called coacervates. These materials are important for applications like gene delivery and wastewater treatment. I am trying to figure out how changes in the polymer composition affect the properties of these materials. In particular, factors like the charge density and hydrophobicity of the polymers may matter a lot. So this description tells me a lot about the problem that the student is working on, but doesn't tell me a lot about what they've actually done or what they've contributed to this project. Alternatively, a student might write a description like this. I am working on synthesizing charged polymers with different charge densities. In this project, I have learned to do air-free polymer synthesis and how to characterize polymers using nuclear magnetic resonance and size exclusion chromatography. I have also learned to use a plate reader for measuring UV-Vis spectra of complexes and use MATLAB to process the data. This description tells me a lot about what the student is actually doing in the lab, but it doesn't really tell me that they've thought about the bigger problem or that they're really doing much beyond just doing the experiments that their mentor tells them to do. Last but not least, a student might write a description like this. I am working on synthesizing charged polymers with varied charge densities, which we plan to use to understand how charge density affects complexation of oppositely charged polymers in solution. Over the summer, I used reversible addition fragmentation chain transfer polymerization to prepare polymers with different percentages of charged groups. This fall, I've begun to study complexation of these polymers using UV-Vis spectroscopy. Although significant work remains to be done, my preliminary data suggests that charge density has a significant impact on the phase behavior of these systems. This description tells me both about what the problem is and what the student has been doing to solve it, but also tells me that they can think about their data and what it means. These are all things that are really important skills to have as a graduate student, and so the more evidence you can give me in your statement of purpose that you have these skills, the better. You'll note that I'm putting a lot of emphasis on undergraduate research experience here. Talking about undergraduate research experience is important because it provides the best evidence that you have the skills to be a successful graduate student. But it also helps provide us with evidence that you have realistic expectations about what graduate school is likely to be like, and that's really important too. If you don't have undergraduate research experience, however, there's still a number of things you can do to help show us that you have these skills. For example, in talking about your coursework, tell us about any particularly innovative approaches you took to solve problems in your classes or in your labs, or if you went above and beyond a course requirement, tell us about that. You can also demonstrate that you can talk about an important scientific problem by telling us about a scientific problem that you find particularly compelling and why. So talking about your undergraduate research experience is best if you can, but if you don't have undergraduate research experience, make sure to still demonstrate those skills to us in some meaningful way. Anyway, evidence that a student can be productive in the lab and can articulate and think about a problem, as well as has realistic expectations about what graduate school is going to be like, are probably the number one things that I look for in a statement of purpose. But there are a number of other things that we look for as well. For example, persistence. Grad school is hard, and there are times when things are going to feel like they're not going right, no matter how hard you try. So are you the kind of student who's going to just give up the first time going gets rough, or are you going to stick with it and push through until things start working? This is something you can provide a lot of evidence for as you talk about your undergraduate research experience, especially if things didn't quite work as planned, which they rarely ever do. How did you regroup and solve the problem? This is also something, though, that you can talk about as you discuss your coursework and other activities. For example, was there a course that started out rough that you were having a hard time with, but then you figured out how to study for and ended up doing well in? That's something I'd like to hear about. Another one is initiative. Are you the kind of student who is going to generate ideas to help move a project forward, or are you just going to sit around and only do the things that your advisor tells you to? That sort of initiative is the kind of thing that can really make a graduate student have an outstanding graduate career, and we love to see evidence of it in student statements of purpose. We definitely also look for evidence that our program is the right fit for you. So that often requires you to do your homework and go visit the webpage and faculty webpages and identify a few faculty that you'd be particularly excited about working with in our department. Include a sentence or two about each one of them and why you're excited about their work. If there are other resources or opportunities at the university that you're particularly excited about, for example, a specialization within the PhD program or an outreach program that you're excited about, or potentials for collaboration, definitely tell us about those as well. The more that you can show us that you've put in the time to figure out why you really want to come to our school, the more likely we are to want to work with you too. Other things we look for include evidence of your potential to be a good teacher, since most graduate students do spend at least part of their graduate career working as a TA. So if you've spent time serving as an undergraduate teaching assistant or a tutor, definitely tell us about that as well. Finally, there are two more things I want to discuss briefly. The first one is bad grades. And by bad grades, I'm talking about things like C's in your core chemistry courses. Should you address these or not? There are kind of two schools of thought about this. There are some people who will tell you that you shouldn't intentionally draw attention to any of the negative aspects of your application, and so you just shouldn't discuss it. On the other hand, a lot of people will say that you should address bad grades, especially if they're extenuating circumstances that really suggest that the poor grade is not a reflection of your true capabilities. And in fact, many schools are now asking you explicitly to address this as part of their prompt for the statement of purpose. Personally, I prefer to see students address bad grades in core chemistry courses, because if they don't, my only option really is to just assume that they didn't get the material. So if you had a family emergency in your sophomore year and you did really poorly in your first semester of organic chemistry, for example, that can be worth mentioning. If you do so, though, don't spend a lot of time dwelling on it and making excuses. Just state that it happened and then move on and draw my attention to, for example, your later chemistry courses where you did really well. Show me that those are the ones that I should be paying attention to as the true reflection of your potential. I will say that this is also something that it can be useful to have one of your references address. So if you have a trusted reference who is familiar with your situation, it might be worth asking them to mention it as well. Similarly, if it took you a while to kind of figure college out and your first, you know, year or two was kind of rough, but then you started doing better in your junior and senior years, draw my attention to that as well. Clear, sustained improvement speaks really well of a student. You want to make sure that I don't miss that. And second, length. Please, 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 please keep your statement of purpose under the maximum length requested by the school. And if there is no maximum length stated, keep it under 2 pages. The professors who make up the admissions committee are super busy people, and the more that you can keep it concise, the better we'll be able to stay focused on your application and really capture all the key points that you wanted us to get. So before I wrap up, I do want to mention that while most of the resources I found on statements of purpose are kind of general, there are a couple that are well targeted to chemistry and STEM disciplines. And so I'll put a link to those in the description box below. Definitely check those out. In particular, for chemistry, the ACS Graduate School Reality Check is a really excellent resource, and I recommend reading the entire thing. I do also strongly encourage you to discuss your statement of purpose with your academic advisor or your undergraduate research advisor, because they'll be able to give you a lot more personalized feedback about it. If you do have general questions about any of the things that I've said in this video, though, please leave them in the comment box down below, and I'll do my best to get back to you. Otherwise, if you're interested in more videos like this, hit the subscribe button. I'm going to try to do a new video every month or two on topics like grad school visits, picking a research group, reading the literature. If there are things that you'd particularly like to see me cover, leave a note about that in the comments as well. In the meantime, thanks very much for watching, and good luck with your applications.